What would happen to a nation where nobody had a Bible? Well, approximately the same thing would happen as would happen to a nation where people had the Bible but didn't read it. There would be less temperance, more drunkenness, less industry, more idleness, less purity, more licentiousness. And what would happen to the crime rate? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossball. Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. Before we look at what happens when people read or don't read the Bible, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank You for the privilege that we have now to read Your Word. And we earnestly pray that Your Spirit will teach us the truth and give us a heart to obey and follow You. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to today's program. Why was sin permitted? What was the first great deception? Today's free book is entitled Darkness Before Dawn. To receive your free copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for offer BF24. And now, Pastor John Grossball.
How is a person saved? The Bible is very, very clear that you cannot be saved by money. Nobody can be saved by purchasing salvation with money. In fact, in both the Old and New Testament, it's declared over and over again that you can't be saved by money. Notice what Peter said to a man who wanted to obtain spiritual wealth or spiritual character, spiritual goods, by money. It says, Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given. He offered them money, saying, Give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said to him, Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. So, salvation cannot be purchased with money. The gift of God cannot be obtained with money. Not only that, but salvation cannot be secured by works of penance or charity. The Bible is very clear about this also. Notice what it says, for instance, in Galatians, the 5th chapter, and the 4th verse about this fact. Galatians 5:4 says, You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by law, you have fallen from grace. And in the book of Romans, talking about this same subject, the Apostle Paul talks about Abraham and how did he receive righteousness. In Romans, the 4th chapter, the Apostle Paul tells how Abraham became righteous. He says, What then shall we say that Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something of which to boast, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. He goes on to say that you cannot obtain the righteousness of God by any type of works. It can only be obtained as a gift. We cannot depend upon salvation because we say, well, I'm a Christian, or I go to such and such a church. There will be many people in the Day of Judgment who have called themselves Christians and have attended churches who will find that they're lost. Jesus made this very clear in the Sermon on the Mount. Notice what Jesus said about it in Matthew, the 7th chapter, verses 21 to 23. He says, Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Notice, These are people that call themselves Christians because they call Jesus Lord. A person who belongs to a non-Christian religion does not call Jesus Lord. Many of them will say, oh, well, he was a good man. Actually, Jesus was either God or he was a very wicked man, because it would be wicked for any human being to claim to be a member of the Godhead. And Jesus accepted worship and claimed to be a divine person. But these people who acknowledge Jesus as Lord, they say that he's Lord, they will still be lost. Notice why. Jesus explains why here in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 7, 21 to 23. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? These are Christians who were working miracles, who said, I have the gift of prophecy, I know I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. But they're still lost. Why? Jesus tells us why in Matthew 7, 23. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Can you imagine being able to cast out demons, being able to work miracles, being able to prophesy and have your prophecies come true, and believe that you were filled with a spirit, the Holy Spirit? And when Jesus comes, he says, I never knew you. How does that happen? Well, the way it happens is that the Bible teaches very clearly that there are two separate supernatural spirits that are seeking to control the minds of men. And the Apostle Paul wrote about this in 2 Corinthians 11. He was very afraid about what could happen to the Corinthian church. And notice what he says. He says, I am jealous for you with godly jealousy, for I have betrothed you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear, lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he who comes preaches another Jesus, is there more than one Jesus? Paul says, if he who comes preaches another Jesus, is there another Jesus? Yes, there is another Jesus. The other Jesus, the name for the other Jesus in the Bible is Antichrist. There is more than one Jesus. He says, if he who comes preaches another Jesus whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit which you have not received. Paul is afraid that they would receive a spirit, all right. They would think it was the Holy Spirit, but it wasn't the Holy Spirit. It was another spirit. Or a different gospel, which you have not accepted. You may well put up with it. So, these are people. They believed that they were filled with the Holy Spirit, but it was a different spirit. They were preaching a gospel, but it was a different gospel. And when Jesus comes, he says to them, I never knew you. They had the spirit, but it was a different spirit. They thought that they were worshiping Jesus Christ, but they were not worshiping the Jesus Christ from heaven. They were worshiping a different one. They were preaching the gospel, but it was a different gospel. And so when Jesus comes, he said this would happen to many. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Lord, you've made a mistake. I know that I'm saved because I've done all these things in your name. And notice what Jesus will say, verse 23. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. You see, these people claim to follow Christ, but they're disloyal subjects. They're not subjects that can be taken to the kingdom of heaven because they're not loyal. They don't keep God's laws. They don't follow His ways. They don't live according to His word. Many, many Christians, according to that text, will lose eternal life. The Apostle Paul, in fact, all the apostles talk about that danger. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about it in 2 Corinthians 6:1. He says, "We then, as workers together with Him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain." Is it possible to receive the grace of God in vain? Evidently, or the Apostle Paul wouldn't warn against it. In the book of Hebrews, he talks about the same thing over and over. Notice what he says in Hebrews 4. He says, "Therefore, since a promise remains of entering His rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to come short of it." And then in chapter 12 of Hebrews, he says, "Pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking diligently lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled." Jesus talked about this. One time when Jesus was passing through the villages, this was not a long time actually before His crucifixion, and there was a person with Jesus who began to wonder, as I don't know who this person was, we were not told the name, but this person began to wonder while he or she was walking with Jesus and listening to Jesus' teachings. You know, the teachings of Jesus require, if you follow them, require purity, require righteousness, require righteous living. And the world was wicked in those days like it is now. And this person began to wonder, when they looked around at the world and they listened to the teachings of Christ, they finally asked the Lord a question. And a very interesting question that they asked. The question they had in their mind was, are there only going to be a few people that are saved? Listen, we'll read it in Luke the 13th chapter. Luke the 13th chapter, starting with verse 22. "And He went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. Then one said to Him, 'Lord, are there few who are saved?' And He said to them, 'Strive to enter through the narrow gate. For many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, "Lord, Lord, open for us," and He will answer and say to you, "I do not know you, where you are from." Then you will begin to say, "We ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets." But He will say, "I tell you, I do not know you where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity." There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and yourselves thrust out. They will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God. And indeed, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last." Notice, Jesus said, you're going to see the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the prophets. You're going to see them in the kingdom of God, and you're going to see yourself thrust out. And there's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth. If you want to do an interesting study in the Gospels, in your Bible, if you look at the different passages where Jesus said that when He would return to this earth a second time, that there would be weeping and gnashing of teeth, you'll find that in every instance that I've checked, in every instance, the weeping and the gnashing of teeth is the people who thought they were saved, but when they come to the end of the world, they're not. A supposed hope, and only that, can prove your ruin. You need to know from the Word of God that your life is in harmony with the gospel, so that your hope of eternal life will not turn out to be a mirage and you come to the end of the world and find that you're mistaken, that your life is not in harmony with the kingdom of God and you're not going to be taken to the kingdom of God. So people say, oh, well, I've established hospitals and I've established schools and I've set up young men in business and I've given large amounts of food and clothing to people in need. Well, that's wonderful. But no amount of good works can save your soul. It is God who gives us by faith that righteousness which by grace alone justifies unto eternal life. Notice how the Apostle Paul explained it in Ephesians, the second chapter. He says, when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Paul had been a strict Pharisee. He says that in Luke 26. He had been a strict Pharisee. But when he met Jesus on the Damascus Road, he found that all of his strict living, everything that he did, none of that would save him or give him eternal life. And he writes about this to the Philippian church. And this is what he says in Philippians, the third chapter. He says, I also might have confidence in the flesh. If anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more. Circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. But indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. After the Apostle Paul met Jesus Christ on the Damascus Road, he turned from the bondage of human religious tradition to the liberty of the sons of God. And the great instrumentality that works this miraculous change out in a person's life is the Bible. What happens in a nation or in a people when people read the Bible or when people don't read the Bible? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
The great instrumentality in changing the character of a person or the character of a nation in a more elevated or righteous way is the Bible or the Word of God. When the Bible is read, there is more temperance and less drunkenness. When people read the Bible, there is more industry and less idleness. When people study the Bible, the result is there is more purity and less licentiousness. Moral greatness is attained only by those who hold life and honor subservient to truth. The problem in this world is that there are so many people that do not read the Bible or do not have these moral principles inculcated in them from the Bible. And you can see it, if you can't see it in the world around you, you can see it in the pages of history. Back in the 16th century, Francis I, the King of France, made a law to prohibit people from publishing, from printing throughout the nation of France. Why did he do that? So that people wouldn't have the Bible, because they were using the printing press to produce Bibles. What was the result of that? What was the result of taking the Bible away from the people? Well, when you study the history of Europe, one of the most awful developments that ever happened in any nation was the French Revolution in the latter part of the 18th century. It was so bad it is even called today by historians that write about it as a reign of terror. How does the darkness of a nation become so dense that they fall into such a state of affairs where atheism becomes the official religion and all morality is laid aside so that there's no such thing as sacredness about marriage, the home, the family, the church, or anything else? Well, when a nation rejects the light of truth, that nation goes into spiritual darkness. The Bible says that the grace of God brings salvation, and it has appeared to all men. But after you behold its power and holiness, after you've been drawn by its divine beauty, if you turn away and choose darkness rather than light, then you have put the heavenly gift from you, and God will not force you to believe. God will not force you to be saved or to become a person who can be a citizen of His kingdom. If you call evil good and good evil, eventually you will fall a victim to your own self-deception. And then you might actually believe that you are doing God's service when you're going directly contrary to His expressed and written will. Your sincerity will not make you guiltless, because the light that would have saved you from deception was willfully rejected. In the book of Deuteronomy, this is what God told to the Hebrew people through His servant Moses. Deuteronomy 4, verse 6. It says, "Therefore be careful to observe them," that is these laws, "for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the peoples, who will hear all these statutes and say, 'Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.'" When a group of people or a nation rejects the gift of heaven, The result is that group of people, that society, that nation, sows the seeds of anarchy and ruin. In Proverbs 8th chapter, the Lord says, "Those that hate me love death." We are living in a time today when the whole world could come into a situation very similar to what happened in France in the latter part of the 18th century. Why? Because today we are living in a time when people have the Word of God. Now, back in those days, 400 years ago, there were people that would have read the Word of God, but they didn't have it. They didn't know it. They didn't understand it. They didn't have it accessible. It was kept from them. And as a result, the moral standards deteriorated. But we're living in a time when people do have the Word of God. It's available everywhere. It's easy for anybody to acquire a Bible. The problem today is, even though people have it, they don't read it. And so, if you have the Bible, but you don't read it, and if that happens in a nation, the same thing develops in that nation as would develop in a nation where they didn't have the Bible. And my friend, it is not as nations or churches or communities, but as individuals that we are converted to God and saved. The work of regeneration must be worked out in the heart, in the conscience, by the power of the Holy Spirit, not by the decrees of councils. The Lord says, it's not by might, it's not by power, but by my Spirit. That's Zechariah 4:6. God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. You can read that from the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 1. How is it with you? Is the Bible a book that you are finding divine wisdom in, or are you just going your own way, thinking that you can figure everything out yourself without any counsel or guidance from a superior, higher power? How is it in your life? How is it in your family? Are you a person who has the Bible but is not benefiting from it because you don't read it? If you want to have eternal life, the Apostle Paul said, this book will make you wise unto salvation.
Even a casual glance at society today tells us that things are not right. To many, the world seems to be spinning out of control. Growing numbers of men and women face the future with anxiety and confusion. The world seems locked in a downward spiral that is fast reaching a climax. Why was sin permitted? What was the first great deception? Today's free book is entitled Darkness Before Dawn. To receive your free copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. And ask for offer BF24. Why has Satan been so successful in confusing so many people? This booklet will explain how Eve yielded to temptation and where the source of spiritual strength comes from, and more. This little book goes to the Bible to answer the important questions about how this great conflict began. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. And ask for offer BF24.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. Steps to Life is supported by your donations. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org.